Okay, so let's get started. Thanks everybody for joining us today for our Cary Institute Scientific Seminar Series. My name is Winslow Hansen. I'm an assistant scientist here and forest ecologist, and it's my pleasure to host Dr. Christopher Ryer, who will be speaking to us today. I'll introduce him in just a moment in a bit more detail, but I wanted to bring your attention to a few upcoming events. So on November 18th, we'll have our next installment of the scientific seminar series, where Dr. Stacy Porter will be discussing time after time, contextualizing recent climate changes using natural archives of Earth's climate history. Sounds very interesting. And tonight we have a special event that the Cary Institute is hosting online that's quite complimentary to the talk we'll be hearing today from Dr. Ryer. This one's entitled Forest Carbon Offsets, Too Good to Be True. And it's a conversation by our own Dr. Charles Canham and the president of Cary Institute, Joshua Ginsberg. So if that's something of interest to you, please click on the link. Well, you can't click on the link. We'll put the link in the chat so that you can click on it and register, and hope to see you there tonight. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Christopher Ryer of the Potsdam Institute of Climate. Christopher is somebody who I've really read a lot of work from for many years. He was very influential in thinking about forest resilience, and I leaned on quite a lot of his work in my PhD. And then more recently, we've had wonderful interactions over the course of the last few years on a paper I led during my postdoc. And so I'm very grateful for Dr. Ryer to join us, and I really look forward to his talk. So take it away. Dr. Ryer. Oh, sorry, one more thing. If you have questions, put it in the question and answer box. And if you have technical issues, please use the chat. And I will moderate Q&A at the end of the talk. Okay, take it away, Dr. Ryer. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Winslow. That's really a nice opportunity. And I'm really grateful to that all of you join me here. Or that I actually are allowed to join you, since you are, I hear you are all in the same room. So that's a great feeling, I guess. I hope you see my screen and everything works fine. Otherwise, give me a quick signal here, but that should have worked. What I would like to do today is really to give you an insight into this presentation that I have been developing over the past years, actually, always with new evidence coming in and thinking about this role that forests actually have in the climate, and especially because I have this background as a forest ecologist, actually a forester as well. I'm always interested also in the let's say the product side to some extent. I think it's actually great. The situation here is unfortunately a bit different than you. We are all back in quarantine and, you know, sitting at home. But I really wanted to do this because I had the feeling over the past 1.5 years, you know, my vision and my views were all getting more and more narrower, focusing on, you know, Europe, Germany. You know, this was all frightening me a bit. So I was really glad that when this opportunity came up here to also, you know, just get in touch with people from the US and so on again. So I'm really grateful to be with you here today. What I would like to do is start a bit off topic, but hopefully you will see the connection after some time. As you know, at the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research, we work in an interdisciplinary way, you know, many climate scientists and so on, interacting with physicists and ecologists. And it is still a common thing that when you start a presentation at PIC, you have to at least mention some ice sheet somewhere, yeah, because it's a big thing of the climate system and so on. So I gave it a try recently with this start here of the presentation. So this slide is about actually not these brave men that you see on the left-hand side, yeah, but it's about the ship that you see on the lower right. It's the HMS Erebus. Erebus is the name of the son of chaos, yeah. So not a nice guy in Greek mythology, and those were actually warships here that were built. But then there was a strange period in Europe, almost no war around, yeah, to fight in. So they were refitted as excursion ships, scientific ships. Those brave men that you see here are first James Ross Clark and then Oscar Franklin were both sort of leading this ship on numerous expeditions. And the first one by Clark went to the Antarctic for several years. They went the furthest south a ship ever went and so on. So they were really brave. And they also managed to get back, which is maybe the best part of it. And then later the ship became really, really famous because it was the lead ship of the expedition from Oscar Franklin to find a way through the Northwest Passage. And that's, of course, a legendary route. As you may know, they tried and they stayed there. And then in the end, they failed. Yeah, and that was quite a rough end, yeah, blocked in the ice for 2 years at least, you know, no food, people getting sick and so on. So there are lots of very horror stories about this basically, but it's true. And the myth was finally solved some years ago when they actually found both HMS Erebus and actually the sister ship is called Terror. They were both found, and you see here on the right-hand side that they're actually just a few 15, 20 meters below the surface, and there's no ice, and yeah, you can dive down and visit it in a few years. There will be even like an archaeological, you know, diving center to exploit this and so on. So it's really a sort of resurfacing, yeah. And of course, you wonder what's the connection with climate change. I have already, of course, told you parts of it. Of course, at the time, the Northwest Passage was mostly blocked with ice. And now more and more ships can go through every year. I heard even that some years ago, there were people on jet skis going through and so on. So a big social media event. And that's, of course, only one side of the coin. The other part is that actually for this very last expedition to go through the Northwest Passage, they were actually putting in a steam engine in this ship. So it was one of the first ocean-bound ships in the end that went out with a steam engine. And as you know, the steam engine as part of the Industrial Revolution has then sort of catalyzed this whole climate change story a lot. Yeah, and just as a side note, what you see in the upper right here is the Ross Ice Shelf, yeah, one of the largest in Antarctica, that is also, of course, melting at rates much higher than one would expect from this historical record. Yeah, so this is just a side note that not all only, of course, Oscar Franklin's part of the voyage was affected is linked, but also the earlier voyages of the Erebus were also linked to climate change now. Okay, so that's the story here. And then the last point about the ship, and then we're going definitely into the forest. Of course, it was a wooden ship, yeah? And that's, of course, a quick connection to our topic here. Because at the time, you know, this all had to be planned very well. And in Europe, there was quite some worries about wood scarcity. So already in the 17th century, when Louis the 14th, Louis XIV, yeah, so the Sun King, I think it's called in English, was ruling France. He was already sitting down with his ministers, and they were deciding, okay, we need large patches of forest with good trees, oak trees, for our navy, so that in 200 years we can still build ships. And of course, then they installed this forest and this Forêt de Tronçais. That's one of those that were really installed and managed as a purpose to supply the French Navy with ships. And then 200 years later, of course, nobody needed this these wooden ships anymore. And people started to use the wood, of course, for all other things. Yeah, and of course, barrels is a famous product in this Forêt de Tronçais, not for wine, but I think for all sorts of whiskies and high spirits. And then, of course, it became a very sort of beautiful area for people to enjoy themselves and recreate and so on. There's a lot of environmental education ongoing because it's also linked with the history and so on. So the current use of those trees is totally different from from the time when they were planted. And this is actually, of course, one of the challenges with climate change. Yeah, the trees are long living and so on, but it's also one challenge for the use of the forest. Yeah, and then I just would like to show you this beautiful slide that is circulating for like 20 years in the German forest science community. And I know it's all in German, but believe me, there are words on this slide that even I don't understand. And basically it says, a multifunctional forestry, forest management can achieve all of this. Yeah, so there's everything, really believe me, there's everything on this slide. Yeah, so on from ecological functioning to how to affect the consumer behavior of people and everything. So forests and forest management are basically doing everything. And the funny thing also about this slide is actually that it's being handed around from forest agency to forest agency, it seems, and everybody is adding things that they also think are important. And then in the end, forests are supplying everything, yeah, and of course, everywhere at the same time. And we all know, of course, that this is not really true, but this is quite often the vision. And I think this is very important when we now later go into the discussion and so on, that this vision and perception of what people expect from the forest is actually quite important in these discussions. Yeah, but what is really the controversy, to put it maybe in a bit more general terms, is that on the one hand, and I'm sure you are all, I don't need to really convince you about this, we have seen really unprecedented impacts on forests around the world. Yeah, these are just two pictures of burning peat forest in Siberia, and then below it's the area picture from the Harz Mountains in Germany, where all the spruce trees and so on are dying because of droughts and bark beetles. And I mean, I could have shown many of these examples also from the US, Canada, and other parts of the world. There's a lot going on in the forest. We know that. And then at the same time, there's also a lot going on in terms of how the forest could or should be used, or yeah, so that goes from stop using forest at all to, you know, we have to replace everything that is made out of plastic by some biomaterials. Yeah, you know, the EU has a big bioeconomy policy that relies heavily on biomass that at the same time should come out of forests that are protected and are increasing in biomass. So you see there's already some problems of policy coherence here, but that's definitely the ambition. Yeah, so textiles, valves, pipes, tires, so everything basically is could be replaced by wood, as these people claim, and of course that's very promising for some, but also very dangerous for others. So these demands are also changing a lot. And of course, one of those demands is also timber construction, and that's a topic I want to go to a little bit later. But I first wanted to finish with this introduction with a little sort of conceptualization of what I want to present next, yeah? And because I think it's always good to just sort these things for yourself. And it's not meant here to be, to be really a strict conceptual framework, but it's more something to organize the thoughts. Yeah, and then it's based on a paper by Gordon Bonan from some years ago, basically outlining how forest and climate interact. And in the most direct way, this happens through surface energy fluxes, the hydrology, and so on. So what you see here on panels, basically A and B, and also the related albedo changes and so on. So that's really the direct interaction with climate, as I call it here, only for this purpose, for the purpose of this presentation. And then you have the, let's say, a bit more indirect connections through the carbon cycling, which of course is also in a sense a direct connection, but there is a time lagged response and so on. That's why I put this here in this a bit indirect way. because of course forests take up carbon from the atmosphere and bind it in their biomass and then releases in respiration and so on. And then the third, which I only called here more indirectly, is that if you take out sort of biomass, use it in construction or in other products, then of course that carbon remains in the product until that product is then burned or somehow transformed so that the carbon is released to the atmosphere. And that's just the basic sort of underlying concepts I want to refer to all the time. And I want to start just with an example of this direct interaction, because I'm not going to go more into detail on that, as is really not my full expertise, but I think it's a very relevant point. Yeah. And the idea is here that actually those surface fluxes, yeah, so albedo changes and also the surface roughness and local climate interaction of vegetation and the forest are actually leading to climate changes that are then changing the entire system. And what they did here, Sebastian Luyasser from Free University Amsterdam and others, they basically calculated, they used a European-wide forest model that has a land surface and everything, so a process-based model. And then they tested different management scenarios that were all meant to mitigate or to contribute to climate change mitigation in a wider sense. So some were focusing on maximizing the in situ carbon sink. Other scenarios were focusing on reducing the air temperature so that the local temperatures are actually lower than expected under the climate forcing and so on. And then they tried the combinations of different management systems and so on. And the controversial finding that was really shaking up all the European, forest science community was that the depending on how you look at it, the climate benefits from the actual forest management are very modest and local. Yeah, and the forest management, because it features, you know, different components, some that contribute to cooling because it changed the surface, others that contribute to warming because you do this and that, you maybe emit more VOCs or whatever. So there is not a clear picture here. And therefore, they say we should rather focus on doing good forest management with, you know, having adapted, resilient forests, but not worry so much but not focus so much on the climate contribution of forests, because that's in any way very arbitrary, let's say, what you actually mean and so on. So this is a very interesting study, very controversial. And if you like, we can discuss this also a bit later, but it's not my main point here. I just wanted to show you that this is definitely a vision on the forest that is not commonly so well or that's not on the mind of every forest scientist when they think about the climate contribution of forest, because it's really a bit about the land surface properties more than the actual forest management. But there is quite some linkages. So this is this one part. And then we have this more indirect part where you can basically separate things into avoiding deforestation, reforesting degraded forests, and afforesting sort of land that was without forest for quite some time. And then the actual forest management activities. And just for the reforestation and afforestation, I wanted to give you one example that, of course, there is a really huge potential. I think we would all just from our feeling, you know, there has been a lot of deforestation, so there should be a lot of potential for restoration and so on. That's of course very true, but then if you look into the literature, the debate is very polarized. Yeah, so of course many people see these positive co-benefits of restoring forests, but then if they are happening as afforestations on land that is maybe a rich ecosystem or that is fine-tuned to local conditions, then you know there can be issues with water supply and so on. And then there was this very controversial paper here by the Jean-François Bastin and others that was then, you know, triggering a lot of replies on whether the land that is considered available for restoration in this approach is actually free land, or whether there will be people displaced because they live there on informal settlements and all these kind of things. Yeah, so there is quite some work on this, which is also very important, of course, but it's also quite a hype to some extent, I would say, because you really have to look into the details of what can be done. And having worked myself in my early years in reforestation projects in Ecuador, I think it's very important to sort of pursue these efforts, but there's also a very sort of, it's very attractive to be sold out and greenwashed. And this is also related to this, what I wanted to show you here. So there's this very famous company, Plant for the Planet, from this Felix Finkbeiner, a German student who actually started as a kid to do in his school to do reforestation projects. And I think this was a very good initiative. It was raising a lot in the environmental awareness in schools. And now he's, I think, in his 20s. And was doing a PhD thesis with the group in at the ETH, working on this restoration stuff. And now, you know, there's quite some controversy because some journalists from a really renowned newspaper, they made a big article about the fairy tale forest, yeah, they call it. So in the end, it's about the forest that is supposed to be planted, actually either already exists and nothing needs to be done, or that the ownership is unclear. And you know, the trees that were planted, they were actually all flooded. So that there was actually no possibility to reforest because the whole area was actually not suitable. So there's quite a controversy about these some of these activities. And while I don't want to comment on this in particular, it just shows to me in a very tragic way how, you know, a very good grassroots initiative led by a young adolescent can then somehow, because with the maybe the wrong ambitions or also the wrong support, turn into quite some controversy on something where you would think, okay, in theory, planting trees, doing something yourself, that's a very powerful message, that's an important part of this narrative. But here, I think it has turned a bit against the cause. So that's the controversy about the reforestation, afforestation thing. I will get back to, we can get back to this also a bit later, because now I really wanted to focus on forest management and on the different products here that are now popping up here below in the lower part of the slide. And you see that, of course, when I talk about forest management, I actually mean everything, the whole range from, you know, having forest reserved for protection of natural processes to, you know, really intensively managed plantations for bioenergy or other things. And the background is that even if you have a forest reserve, there needs to be some kind of management, there needs to be, you know, boundaries drawn, and then the buffer zones, there needs to be some kind of monitoring, and all this to some extent I keep it as part of forest management. Yeah, roads need to be safe that go inside, and so on. So that's why I also keep it here as management. And there is actually quite some controversy along these lines that you see below, because as you can imagine, you can either store more carbon in the forest, you know, focus on other co-benefits for biodiversity, or you can harvest and, you know, focus on wood products and so on. And that's what I want to go a bit more into detail in the next 20 minutes or so, or next for the remainder of my talk. So we are really focusing on the construction sector and so on. And what is behind is that, of course, the now that the energy system is starting to decarbonize and we see promising avenues there, the next elephant in the room is the construction sector, as they are really responsible for a large share of the emissions that we are still putting out every day. That's why we have come up with this thought, or actually others have, of course, also thought about it, whether we can transform the construction sector to actually mitigate climate change. And you see this here on this sketch. Yeah, it's only a cartoon that the of course, all those fossil fuels that were created in prehistorical times, they were then released, and part of those were actually used, of course, to build our nice cities that you see here in the middle, with these supporting the historical mineral-based construction materials like concrete and steel. And then the idea is that through the use of bio-based construction materials, mass timber, engineered timber, whatever you call it, and a fully coupled, recycling, upcycling process, there is actually the possibility to create also a carbon sink in cities and construction elements. The idea why using wood is that wood has, in comparison to conventional construction materials, a good carbon balance, because steel and concrete almost don't store any carbon, while wood has this potential, and also during the production process, the energy demand and so on is not that large. And I'm really talking here not only about, beams and stuff, but really also these mass timber and engineered products that you see here on the right hand. So all these laminated products. And maybe just one note for the cement that you see here on the left hand side. So cement, of course, also can store carbon, but these numbers that you see here, so the 12 ton maximum, that's really over a long time, so that all the calcium carbonate and so on has been carbonized and so on. Okay, so this is why wood, and then of course there are other reasons, the sand mining that is needed for concrete production. That there's of course a big threat to aquatic ecosystems and their carbon cycle, and also the mining land use change from mining is also quite a damaging activity that is responsible for quite some forest loss, as you can see an example here. And that's of course not only mining for steel for the concrete sector, but it's part of the issue, I would say. So the idea was really to see how mass timber constructions can reduce the emissions of primary structures and enclosures. And we did that together with the architects at Yale New Haven in the group there. And they designed all sorts of different housing types and then calculated the flooring area and how much primary structure and enclosures you need and so on. And then we designed very simple scenarios looking at the growth of the urban population until 2050, and that's about around 2.3 billion in this United Nations scenario we were using here. And then we were simply assuming that those new houses that were needed for these 2.3 billion would be built 10% out of timber, 50% or 90%, or in a business as usual case, I think it's 0.5% timber, that's the current rate. Then we were calculating the emissions that sort of come, and the error bars you see are across the different flooring areas. So the average is the current floor area that the global average, and then there is a higher one and the lower one for the error bars. This is really only looking at the emissions that happen during the production of the materials. So there is no, let's say, harvesting emissions included. There is no missing growth included that you have because you harvest trees and that are then not, regrowing or that are not continuing to grow. But on the other hand, we also do not include the carbon uptake through regrowth. These are just things to consider and to discuss. And I will show you some follow-up studies where we then include this to some extent. So first we see clearly here that the cumulative emissions are much lower with the 90% timber scenario and also already in the 50% timber scenario. So that's the first message here. And then you don't only have the energy demand reduction or the reduced emissions during the production of the material, but also over time, you can then, of course, increase the number of houses and that will also store your carbon. And here we simply assume that the houses are built. And since we only look at the 2050, sort of these new houses will not be demolished. Yeah, so this is an important assumption here since we stop our calculations at 2050. Yeah, until then, these buildings made out of engineered timber could store between 10 to 700 million tons of carbon per year. And that's really the range across this 10 to 90% scenario, and then the different flooring areas and so on. And I've just put you the cumulative numbers here for this time period. And you see that, okay, maybe, you know, these very 90% with a very large floor area is quite an upper range. But if you look a bit at the 50% scenario, we end up with, let's say, 5 to 10 gigaton of carbon. And just to put this into perspective, below I put the calculator of how much CO2 we have left until we reach the 2-degree target and how much time we have with the current emission level. So that's in like 25 years. And the budget we have left is about 1 trillion of CO2. So if you convert that into carbon, this is about 300 gigaton of carbon. So you see this is some percentage of that. At least this is at least a number that matters if we think about 5 to 10 gigatons of carbon stored in these houses in a medium scenario. But then you already probably read on my slide that I didn't read this last part, if enough wood is available. Yeah, so of course we need quite some timber to fulfill the demand in this 50 and 90% scenario. And what you see here is the annual demand of harvested timber, and that's across all, you know, just biomass at the moment. And then the orange line shows you the FAO 2015 saw log harvest, the actual one, the observed one, and the blue line shows you the total timber harvest in 2015 from the FAO. And what you can notice, of course, is that, for example, the very high 90% scenario with the high flooring area would basically mean that we need all the wood that was harvested in 2050 every year to support these constructions, which is quite a lot, and would of course mean that this wood is not available for all these other purposes that it has been used for already. But if you look a bit into the more, let's say, moderate scenarios, the intermediate scenario, then you could see, okay, this would mean quite an increase in saw logs harvesting, but it would be in a similar range, let's say. And then we looked into some studies that actually project future forest harvests, and there are two studies that we considered here. The one is here a bit older one, a very, let's say, rather simple assessment of the potential of plantations to produce a lot of wood on a very small area. And in these different scenarios that I will not go into detail here, you see that there's actually quite some harvest available from plantation forests. And then we also used data from a global vegetation model, J.S. Bach, that was driven with a forest management scheme where everywhere the annual growth is harvested, so it's sustainable yield harvesting. And all the protected areas are masked out. Yeah, so this is basically the upper range if you were taking out everything that has been grown in the years before everywhere where forests are not protected. Yeah, this is of course also a hypothetical number, but you see that it's actually quite large. Yeah? And this is actually even including fire as a disturbance, but not wind and insect. Yeah, so this is also even included in here. But still, I think so there is some prospect for increased forest harvesting in the literature, and we can discuss this. I think this is a big point that I will also come back later in my German example for Germany. But essentially, this would mean, okay, we should either harvest more or we should use the existing harvested wood material differently, reroad flows, try to upcycle and get the biomass, you know, from recycling and things like that. Yeah, so these are really the open questions here. Because just to show you some nice data that we recently collected from in a project cooperating with Russia. Of course, we know that the harvesting and the forest sink are coupled. Yeah, and what you see here is the harvesting levels of the whole Russian Federation over the last, 80 years or so, split into the European and the Asian part. But the big line, the brown line is the total on the left-hand side. And then on the right-hand side, you see since the 90s, the net carbon sink of the managed forest. And if you look a bit into these specific time periods from the 90s to the year 2000s, when the sort of Soviet Union was breaking down and harvests were really going down, yeah, you see that from a very low level of the sink with high harvests, then this recovery where the forest was regrowing and harvesting was reduced, then actually there was quite an increase in the sink. So we know that these dynamics are somehow coupled, and this is of course with all the urgency of mitigation and what to do best, this is of course a very important point. And then also I think in next Monday or so we will launch the UNECE Forest Sector Outlook Study, where also colleagues from the US Forest Service were involved, using the Global Forest Product Model, in which we also then designed a kind of wood building scenario, a different one than the ones that I have shown you before. So here we are really talking about building every 10th new house in China from wood, and we were not changing any other scenario assumption, and then looking at the let's say the carbon balances here, and you see here that the harvesting reduces sort of the biomass everywhere in these regions that are shown in this table. And then, of course, there is a large storage in the harvested wood products in China, actually here, and also emissions are reduced in China. Yeah, this is according to the IPCC accounting rules, where the stocks in the products are assigned to the wood producing countries, while the emissions are assigned to the consuming country. Yeah, but so you see that a lot of wood is sourced from Asia. And it is also used there in this scenario. And still, the balance is slightly negative. Yeah. So in the end, these reductions in biomass around the world to basically support the wood trade and so on lead to a slightly negative carbon balance. And of course, there are many assumptions. Actually, the model is not fully designed to capture all these elements. So you have to be a bit careful also. About how to interpret this. For example, the harvest efficiencies are rather low, the substitution factors are not changing, and they are very static, so there's no improvement in technologies and so on. And then there are the wood products are not as innovative as they actually are today, and so on. And also, for example, climate impacts are not fully included here. So there are a lot of things to sort of account for here. We see that this carbon debt that you produce by removing trees, yeah. So what I mentioned earlier, this missing growth is definitely something that we need to better grasp and include into the modeling in general. Then I just wanted to highlight this last study here that is basically making the same point that there's not only the land cover change that has an effect on carbon stocks, but also the management itself and what they did in this nice paper. So they compared all different sorts of data sets on the actual carbon storage and the potential carbon storage of different biomes. And you see then always in these bar plots that actually the land management contribution is quite a lot in the tropics, at least. And really makes reduces the potential carbon stock by quite an amount. So, in the to take the other to look at it the other way around, if we were seizing the management or improving the management in a way that it would help the vegetation to regain stocks, that would also already save quite some carbon. And I think that's really still open to a lot of scientific inquiry here, what to do best, or probably in different situations, there will be different solutions. I wanted to give a quick now, where are we? Yeah, 40 minutes, so that's perfect. I wanted to give a quick midterm, or no, end term summary here. So clearly, we have seen that forest management somehow feedbacks also on the climate itself. And this, in my view, is an issue that we don't look at enough. And I think we should keep this much more in mind. And then we have seen the controversies about forest restoration, both afforestation and reforestation. So these products, these projects have a lot of potential, but they need to also be thought through quite well. And especially it's important which land use is actually being replaced and whether the plantations have a chance to succeed. Then we have seen that in forest management, it really depends a lot on the goals. So are these more high carbon stocks that we want to feature? Are they actually safe under climate change? Or do we want to rather focus on high product stocks and substituting concrete and steel, for example, or also other issues? What I didn't talk about is, because I'm really not an expert on it, but to some extent you have a presentation this evening on that, I realized, is on this accounting issue. You know, there are big controversies on how to set actually the forest reference level. So what is the actual normal climate contribution of a forest, and then how does this contribute to the carbon policies of individual countries? And there's a big debate, for example, in Germany right now, what is actually the current baseline development of the forest? So how much carbon would the forest actually store under normal conditions, where nobody knows what normal is, to then decide what part of it can be accounted for in the UNFCCC processes and so on, and can actually help to fulfill the climate benefits of Germany and the EU. So this is a big controversy, but I think we have to keep this for another time, or you will see something related to that tonight. There's absolutely no controversy about stopping deforestation. I was keeping this out all the time. I think it's fine to simply state this here. I think 25% of the emissions still come from land use change and so on. So stopping deforestation is really, there's no controversy about that. Yeah, so that's a good thing in that regard. I just wanted to highlight a few more points for the discussion, hopefully, or just to also put things a bit into context. And then I'm really happy. I see that there are many comments in the chat and in the Q&A, so I'm really looking forward to that. So I really want to finish on time. I already said this almost, just going back to the study before, I think I find it quite interesting that there are actually quite some differences in between the different biomes. Yeah, so while in the tropics, I think this land management seems to have quite a strong contribution to the reduction in the carbon sink, actually in the temperate and boreal zone, and it the contribution, or especially in the temperate, is not that large maybe. So maybe that's also something to discuss and consider, whether these, whether we should actually aim for more regionalized solutions, and then also make sure that the governance frameworks and the global climate policy frameworks are fitting these more regional needs and so on. I think that's the key point here. And then I wanted to highlight one other sort of unknown in this whole thing. So this is an abandoned airfield in Sweden in 2005-2006, after the storm Gudrun hit the country. And you see, this is a lot of timber, and it's actually not the only of such things, airfields, but in this one storm, they actually got 75 million cubic meter of wood damage. So that's 75 million this airfield basically filled with timber, and that's more or less all the timber they harvest in one year. And Sweden is the big timber country in Europe, so all the harvest from one year was blown down in one night. And of course this has a strong effect also on the carbon balance. And we have a nice study here that is already some years old with a colleague that also Winslow knows very well, Rupert Seidel, where we systematically analyzed the literature on forest disturbances. And of course, you can imagine that within a drier and warmer world, we get a lot of increases in drought, fire, and so on. But maybe the more interesting message that we actually found was that these disturbances are interacting quite a lot. So we specifically looked for papers that were studying interactions between the different disturbance agents. And you see here on the left this nice sort of interaction diagram, or I don't know how you call these type of plots. But what is really worrying is shown on this dry bar plot to the right, because whenever the color of the bar is black, it means that the interaction between disturbances was actually amplifying the effect. Yeah, so that drought was triggering fire and bark beetles, and storm is triggering further effects from pathogens and so on. So that in most of the cases, actually, the disturbance interactions are increasing the damages. And I think our current models and so on may account for disturbance like fire, but they surely don't account for these interactions. Yeah, and just to show you what it means, this is a simulation for the entire area of Germany. So 11 million of forest, 11 million hectares of forest. Here I show you only the coniferous stands, and we have a scenario where we don't manage the forest at all, and that then gives you quite a steady increase in growing stock. And we can discuss the details here later. But what I really want to show you is that then when we introduce disturbances similar to the ones that we have experienced in the past and mortality rates, then we actually get this a pink line that is very similar actually to what we see if with current management and so on. So really the additional regrowth is all being damaged by disturbances in this type of scenario setting. I just wanted to quickly show you that. And then my very, very last point, to come back to this perception issue that I mentioned in the beginning. There is also quite some social science research that I think we should really consider worthwhile looking into to understand and to discuss these controversies, because people simply have different perceptions of what the forest is. And the Bavarian forest, that's the first German national park that was installed 50, 60 years ago. There is a big controversy ongoing for many years, because part of the population that actually live there, they have a specific expectation that these should be, green forests. They support our livelihoods. We can produce timber there. And now, okay, we have the national park. Okay, we have tourists. We can change our livelihoods. But now they let the forest die. And now, we have dieback because of climate change and insects. And now they let the forest die, and that's our home. So this is really this term. It's a literature term of Waldheimat. So it's really the forest home, and people are really feeling strongly about that. And on the other hand, you have those people that think, this is a natural dynamic. Forests are part of a natural system. So there has to be wilderness. And in wilderness, things burn, things die, and you have competition. And that's why it's good that this is happening. And those perceptions, they are really shaping the entire debate since 20, 30 years. So there have been nice interviews of all these people and, all the different groups that were almost, fighting each other on the parking lot in the national park and so on. So there is quite some research, and this really matters to understand how people think about the forest, besides the numbers that we can compute with our models and our data. Okay, and with this, I'm ready. I just wanted to highlight these points once more: the regional differences, the role of disturbances, the people's perceptions of forest, and of course, the urgency of mitigation. Yeah, we know we have very little time. Glasgow, the COP in Glasgow is coming to an end tomorrow or on the weekend after that, and we know we have little time. And the role here is really crucial. Yeah, so substitution benefits will be less in a few years because the energy system has been transformed and so on. So this all is part of this discussion. yeah, I will skip this. We can discuss this later. And I would like to thank you for your attention. I hope I'm steering a lot of controversial debates now here with you. And I leave you with this very nice artwork that actually a person produced, a student in Sweden, during the first Corona lockdown. He was sending on this, hey, I was at home and I saw your paper and I have rebuilt it out of wood as a 4x3 meter, you know, panel that you can put on your wall. So this is hanging somewhere in Sweden on the wall. And I think it's very nice to see your scientific figure being turned into some kind of artwork. So I'm showing this around now all the time and I hope you also like it. Thanks a lot.
Great, thank you so much for that very interesting talk, Dr. Ryer. As you can see, we have lots of questions and comments, far too many for us to be able to get through in the 9 minutes we have left. I wanted to start off by asking a question myself, and I'm curious, in the different scenarios that you used for what proportion of housing is based on wood. What were some of the thoughts that your author group had on trade-offs in terms of ecosystem services under those different scenarios?
Yeah, I think that this is the whole paper is really a very interdisciplinary team. And my feeling was when I sort of my position was always to bring in those ecosystem services in the narrow sense, yeah, but And I had to always, you know, but we will be harming biodiversity, you know, also it increased harvesting, it reduces the runoff and things like that, yeah. But I learned something from these, and you can tell me if I'm really wrong here, but they were mentioning a lot of, let's say, positive aspects of wooden houses, yeah. So you have better air filtering, you have a better living quality because the sounds are dampened. So they had all sorts of, let's say, construction services, yeah, that you get improved with wooden houses. And I found this really very fascinating, yeah, that actually there is such a difference between living in a concrete house and in a nicely designed wooden house. So that's the first part. And then the second part, I think most of the focus would still be on, okay, we need to harvest more. This has an effect on forest integrity in areas where forest governance is weak, where forest management is not in a position to guarantee that the management is done in a sustainable way. I think that's as far as we go into the discussion in the paper, not being too concrete about the actual ecosystem services at threat.
Okay, thank you. And now a question from Sarah Batterman. And folks out there, feel free to put questions in the Q&A if you'd like to ask during the next few minutes. From Sarah Batterman, she asked, what types of tree species, temperate, tropical, would be used in timber construction? And might a market demand for timber harvest for construction material drive deforestation in the tropics? How much biomass carbon of the harvested trees would be locked up versus wasted and released to the atmosphere?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so these are two very key points. Yeah, so the production efficiency, that's a key point. But the other point is actually, I want to first go and talk about the tree species, because that's a key issue. And I can give you the example from Central Europe. Yeah, after the Second World War, there was a lot of reforestation with fast-growing coniferous tree species because they grow well. You can use them for, you know, everything the wood industry wants. They can get it from this tree more or less, so they are all very happy. And I think, you know, the situation is similar in some parts of the states and so on. So there's really a strong focus on coniferous tree species, and especially in the construction sector as well. However, and this is now actually not something that was triggered by this climate debate, but already in Germany and Central Europe here since like 20, 30 years, people understand that these coniferous plantations, they are no longer viable. Even before climate change, people were seeing that this is not a good thing. They had too many damages from storms and so on, because they grow out of their natural range. So now, since 20, 30 years, forests are converted and deciduous species are brought in into mixtures. Yeah, so now we are going away from one species, one plantation, one age to more like mixed forest and so on. And this is happening on a large scale. Yeah, so this is a large scale forest change. And also, since 20 years, the industry is sort of fighting, saying we will have plenty of soft of hardwood that we cannot use, yeah, in small dimensions that nobody wants that. And then now we are saying, okay, now you know that this will change. So now you have 30 years to adjust. Yeah. So actually, which industry has 30 years to adjust to changing demands and changing supply as well? Yeah. So this is a bit the argumentation here that we have in these discussions with the ministry at, for Central Europe, because there is a big demand for wood that we don't want to produce in the moment. And while at the moment, I think the forest managers and wood industries, they really like this idea of timber building and so on. They also need to understand, and in every presentation where I'm presenting this to these groups, I'm always stressing, this also means a transformation of the wood industry. Yeah? It's not only a transformation of the forest management or so. It's really a transformation of the whole thing. And that links to your second questions, and I will only go into in very short here, sorry. That this also means that the production efficiencies have to be dramatically improved, for example, in some systems. Yeah, I mean, in Siberia, basically half of the trees are harvested and put on the ground so that the machine can roll on it to harvest the rest. Yeah, and this is, of course, not sustainable nor in any way climate friendly, I would say. So. And these kind of things need to be addressed in governance frameworks, in management guidelines, certification schemes, and so on.
Great, thank you so much for that. Okay, now a question from Charlie Canham. So it's good to see global figures, but when you think about the opportunities, where, what countries do you realistically think wood construction could have the biggest impact, and with what changes in current forest management?
Yeah, that's also a very good point. And if you remember on the slide where I introduced these 2.3 billion, you can see that actually the distribution, the regional distribution, is heavily skewed towards Asia, of course, and Africa. Yeah, so a lot of these new houses need to be built in those regions. And that's actually quite interesting because I think for Africa, the deforestation rates are really high and it's quite a challenge, I would say. But in Asia, as you might know, China has this massive reforestation program that is already has already matured for like 10, 15 years and other regions as well. So there is quite some forestry also ongoing. There is also a lot of deforestation still, you know, towards Siberia and so on ongoing. But I think there is really scope for, you know, with governance and certification and so on to actually have some of the timber in a place where it's also needed for the houses. Yeah, so that's actually a bit a good thing. But then of course, this is really something we are also working on, is now to really find out a bit the regional granularities, yeah, and where it's actually more important to reroute current wood uses to other uses or to support houses, whereas in other areas it may be actually possible to harvest more and so on. And there's one additional point related to that, because that's also what we are currently assessing. There's actually the competition with food and land for agriculture, yeah, because that's also a part of this. And this is also not trivial in these scenarios. But we think, to finish, that there are ways that this is possible.
Great. Thank you so much. So that concludes our hour. I want to thank Dr. Christopher Ryer for presenting and sharing his ideas with us and answering our questions so generously. And some of us will be meeting with him again this afternoon, 3 o'clock Eastern time, and we look forward to a continued spirited discussion. So for those of you out there, feel free to join us again next week, and thanks for attending. Thanks, Dr. Ryer.
And please, yeah, do you have my mail, or can you share my mail, right? So people feel free to drop me your mails and questions. Yeah, I will also try to get somehow a hand of the chat. It will be, I'm really interested to see all your points because now we probably only touched some of it.
So we have this recorded and we'll be able to share this with you.
Okay, thanks a lot. Yeah, and really thanks everybody. It's an honor to be in front of you and speak to you.